So in today's session, we are going to resume with the concept of domain and range for polynomial functions. Last class, we covered quadratic polynomials, isn't it? Okay. So today I'm going to start with cubic polynomial. Cubic polynomial means degree 3 polynomial. Okay. Now a typical cubic polynomial is going to look like ax cube plus bx square plus cx plus d. Correct? This is a cubic polynomial. Remember in the bridge course, we didn't go beyond a, you can say, pure cubic polynomial. We didn't have anything other than x cube, right? But in reality, when you talk about cubic polynomial, you may have terms containing x square, x and constants. Okay. However, our main agenda is not to go into the depth of sketching the graph, but to know the domain and the range for cubic polynomial, because that is what is going to be coming up for you in your school exam also, and of course, JEE and other competitive exams as well. So any cubic polynomial, if you see, it has a very interesting trend depending upon the leading coefficient. So leading coefficient plays a very, very vital role here. If your leading coefficient is positive, please note the following trend. The trend is, as x will become very, very large, the function f of x will also become very, very large. Okay, you want to call f of x, y, whatever you want to call it. Okay, so when your leading coefficient is positive, your x, if it becomes very, very large, your y value will also become very, very large. Okay. And if your x becomes negatively very, very large, then your f of x will also become negatively very, very large. Okay. Why? Because see, it's very simple. If this is positive and if your x is very high, it doesn't matter whatever is the sign of b, c, and d, because leading coefficient or this term x cube will have more dominance as compared to the other terms. So if you keep your x very large and your a is positive, then your y, which is your f of x, let me write it down here, your y, that will also become very, very large. Okay. And if your x is negatively very, very large, it doesn't matter whatever is your b, c, d, whether they are positive, negative, zero, because of this dominance of this term, your y will also become negatively very, very large. Is it fine? Now, under such a situation, when you sketch the graph of this type of function, you would realize that this graph will always end with an arm up and an arm down. See the motion of the arrows over here. So it will be something like this. I hope you can see me on my camera. So one hand will be up and one hand will be down for the graph, right? So it is trying to indicate, It tries to indicate that as your x is infinitely big, so will be your y. And as x is infinitely small, or you can say negative infinity, so will be your y as well. Are you getting my point? Now, one such typical example that you know of is your x cube graph, right? So one example I will give you, x cube graph, since you have done this in your bridge course, I would like to revisit this graph for you again. In x cube graph, what do you see? Let me make my axis here. In x cube graph, the graph is like this. Yeah. So just focus on these two arms. Where is it heading towards? It's heading towards plus infinity as your x goes to plus infinity. And it's heading towards minus infinity as your x goes to minus infinity. Okay. Now, in this case, you would see that there is only one point that we talked about in the bridge course, and that was this point, which is called the inflection point. Okay. What is inflection point? You need not bother right now. It's too early to talk about inflection point. Inflection point is anyways our subject matter when we are doing calculus. Okay. So here, what is important for us to know is that a cubic polynomial graph can have several peaks and valleys. Okay. When I say several, it cannot exceed more than one peak and one valley. Okay. So I have not drawn it in many of the situations, but today I will try to draw it. Let me go to the GeoGebra screen over here. I'll try to show you from there. Okay, so let's draw a typical cubic polynomial graph having some values of b, c, and d, and of course your a. So let's say I draw y is equal to x cube minus let's say 4x square, okay, plus let's say 2x plus 2. Okay, if you see this graph again, it is following the trend which I told you a little while ago, right? Its top arm here is going towards plus infinity as your x is going towards plus infinity, and the bottom arm is going towards minus infinity as your x is going towards minus infinity. In between, there can be peaks and valleys. By the way, these points are called stationary points in mathematics. Now, what is stationary points? Need not worry about it right now, but these are the points where the slope of the tangents at these points become parallel to the x-axis. Okay. Why it is called stationary point, we'll discuss all those things a little later on. As of now, that is not our relevant topic, because if I start talking about everything in the same chapter, this chapter will become humongous. Okay. Anyways, so please do not have this misconception that it is always having an inflection point like that, which I showed in X cube. It will have some peaks and valleys inside in between, but I'm not concerned about this part. I'm not concerned about this part. Okay. Many people in the last class, I talked about this in one of the sessions, and they said, sir, how do you know at which point a valley comes and at which point a peak comes? But that calculus is required. As of now, don't worry about it. What is important is the domain and range for this. Okay. So look at this graph and comment on the domain and the range of it. Anybody, I would request you to write it on your chat box. What do you think is the domain and the range for this graph? What's the domain and the range? Very good, Achintya. Very good. How about others? Hi, Arya. How are you doing? Very good, Vihan. Now are you able to hear me? Is everybody able to hear me? Hey, thank you. I'm good. Thank you for asking me. I'm good, dear. Okay, so as you can all see, this graph has an extension from minus infinity to plus infinity along the x-axis, and along the y-axis also it goes from minus infinity to infinity, correct? So you can say that the domain of this function is all real numbers, and range of this function is also all real numbers, okay? You can either write an R or you can write minus infinity to infinity. Both are same things. Is it fine? Now, many people ask me, sir, this is the story when your A is positive. That means your leading coefficient is positive. How would this graph behave had the leading coefficient been negative? Let's talk about that as well. But before I move on, is there any question with respect to this? Okay. So many people will ask, sir, what about the remaining part of the graph? See, I'll not draw the remaining part of the graph. As I told you, it could have various scenarios. It could be like this. No, it could be like this. It could be like this. Okay. So there can be so many cases happening in between, which is basically dependent upon your B, C, and to a certain extent on D as well. Okay. Right now, my main purpose is not to go into those details. I'll go into them when the right time comes. Okay. All right. So let's talk about what happens when your A is negative. Okay. Let's talk about that case. So when your A is negative, that means the leading coefficient is negative. Please understand this. When your X becomes very, very large, your F of X will become negatively very, very large. Are you getting my point? Now, why is that so? Very simple. If this is negative quantity, A is negative quantity, and if you increase your X very large, because of this negative quantity, things will become very, very negatively large for f of x. Others, B, C, D, they will not be able to save it. Okay. B, C, D, they have no, you can say, dominance over this guy A. A is the boss. What A will say, they will have to follow. Okay. That is why it is called leading coefficient. So if A is negative and x is very, very large, f of x will become negatively very, very large. So it'll become negative infinity. And ulta will happen when your x is tending to minus infinity. So if x is tending to minus infinity, f of x will tend to plus infinity. Because of this, the graph of such kind of functions will look like this. Okay. So see, when x is very, very large, this graph will have a end arm down, right? Signifying that when you are taking a very large value of x, y will become negatively very, very large. And it will have one hand up. Okay. Something like this. You can see me on the screen, right? Something like this. Okay. Other one was like this. This one is like this. Like this. Okay. So it'll be dancing like this. So if your x is negatively very, very large, y will become positively very, very large. Is it clear? Okay. I will show you some instances. Don't worry, on the GeoGebra as well. Meanwhile, any question anybody has? Any questions? It's mirrored over y-axis. Not exactly, Jatin. I should not say that mirror over y-axis. Y-axis mirroring happens for some other reasons. When your graph basically you can say unchanged, when you change your x with a minus x, that type mirroring happens. In this situation, mirroring is, you cannot use the word mirroring. That would not be an appropriate word over here. Okay. Anyways, just an example for this, I would like to show you the graph of negative x cube. Okay. Negative x cube graph basically looks like this. We have already seen this in our bridge course days. So it is like this. Yeah. So as your x is very, very large, it goes towards minus infinity, and if your x is negatively very, very large, it goes towards plus infinity. Okay, I will show these graphs in general as well. Any other question anybody has? Could you repeat which part do you want me to repeat regarding the orientation of the graph? Yes, so what I was saying, Arya, that if you have your leading coefficient as negative. If you had your leading coefficient as negative, if x is very, very large, the graph f of x value or the y value will become negatively very, very large, and vice versa. So because of that, the orientation of the graph will be this. In between, some khichdi will happen, which I am not commenting on this because it depends upon B, C, and D. So in between, some, you know, activity might happen, which depends upon B, C, and D also, which I'm not commenting right now. Okay. So let us look into one of such graphs on GeoGebra. Now, same graph, I'm going to make a minor change. Instead of an X over here, I'll put a minus X. See the nature of the graph, right? The moment I press an enter, see what will happen. Do you see this? Let me drag it a little bit up. Okay, do you see this graph? So if you see this graph, as X becomes very, very large, this guy goes to minus infinity. So when x is very, very large, it goes to minus infinity. And when x is very, very negatively large, this goes to plus infinity, right? So opposite trend is being shown by it. In between, some peaks and valleys are there. But as I told you, I am not going to talk about it. What I'm going to talk about is what is the domain and the range, because that is our subject matter of study in this chapter. So what do you think is the domain range for this graph? Tell me fast. Domain range. Bega. Right, Achintya. Absolutely. Very good. Awesome. So in this case, also, you would realize that the domain and the range will be all real numbers. No difference from the case where your leading coefficient was positive. Okay. So domain, all real numbers, range, all real numbers. Right. So what is the conclusion over here? The conclusion over here is that any cubic polynomial, if a question comes in your school exam, to find the domain and the range, blindly close your eyes, not even have to look. Right domain is all real numbers, range as all real numbers, right? Of course, write it against the proper question. Okay, so if the question setter says, find the domain and range for something like -7x³ plus 6x² plus 2x minus 100. Okay, now don't worry, cubic polynomial, right? Domain is all real numbers. Okay, so don't have to even waste a single moment. Domain will be all real numbers. Range, all real numbers. Over, finish. This is your answer. Okay. Don't have to worry whether leading coefficient is positive, negative, whether there are other terms or not. Domain range will always be -∞ to ∞, respectively for both of them. Is it fine? Any question anybody has? Okay. Later on, we'll find something more interesting. Okay. I'll add something more interesting to it. Now, can I go on to the next polynomial? Any questions here anybody has? No doubt. Great. So now let's talk about the biquadratic polynomial. I'll be slightly faster here because we have already done this. It's all about recalling biquadratic polynomial. Degree 4 polynomials are called biquadratic polynomials. So a typical biquadratic polynomial will have something like this: ax to the power 4, bx³, cx² plus dx plus e. Okay. Of course, when in the bridge course I was discussing about biquadratic polynomial graph, I never made a mention of such a heavy one. Basically, I dealt with a very pure form of a biquadratic, just having x4 term. But it is quite possible that a biquadratic polynomial can have other terms like x³, x² x, and constant in them. Okay. Now again, the leading coefficient plays a very, very important role. What is the role it plays? If your leading coefficient is positive, okay, then the graph will show the following characteristic. What will it show? If x is very, very large, you tell me now. F of x will be, just write INF or minus INF. Infinity or minus infinity? What do you think? Very good, Jatin. Very good, Achantya. Awesome, guys. You are superb. Okay. It'll go to plus infinity. Very good. And as x goes to minus infinity, y will go to minus infinity. Very good. So this tells you that, one second. It will still go to infinity. See, you have raised this to a positive, even power, right? So if you put minus infinity, even power will convert it to a positive quantity, right? So everybody got carried away there, right? So what does it tell you that? It tells you that irrespective of whether you're going towards plus infinity or minus infinity, the graph will always go up. Up means plus infinity, right? So the end arms of the graph, my dear, would always be facing upwards, as if like pointing towards 6, the way the cricket umpire says 6. So 6. Okay. So in between something will happen. Again, I'm telling you, I'm not going to comment about what will happen in between. In between, some peaks and values will happen, but maximum you will have 3 sets of peaks and values. Okay. There may be none also. So in between something will happen, but what I'm more interested in is that its end will be towards, if it goes to a very large value of x, y value will also go very large. And if it goes to a negatively very large value of x, y value will still go very large. Okay. In between something will happen. I mean, I'm not in a state to comment about it till I know the value of b, c, d, and e, etc. Okay. So this is very interesting observation. So this goes to plus infinity. This will also go to plus infinity. And if this goes to minus infinity, this will also go to plus infinity anyhow. Okay. Now, I will show you some instances of the graph. Let's look into some graph from GeoGebra. So let me show you a graph of GeoGebra. Now, same graph, let me just make a minor modification. Let me remove this and let me put a power of 4 over it. Ayo. of 4. Yeah, there you see. So let me drag it down. So what you see is it has got a unique kind of a valley and a peak over here. And you can see here that the graph is always going towards positive infinity, irrespective of whether you're going towards infinity or minus infinity on the x-axis. Okay. So the two arms are always up. Are you getting my point? Now, when you're given such a graph and somebody says, hey, what do you think is the domain of this function? What will you say? Domain means what is the span? Achintya, you're partly correct, but not completely correct. Exactly, Arnav. Exactly, Arya. So domain for such kind of function. So let me go back to my black screen. Domain for this function is going to be all real numbers. Okay. But what about range? What about range? Now for range, my dear students, let's go back to our GeoGebra graph. Range for this graph will be from this point onwards. This point onwards, whatever is this value, okay, all the way till plus infinity, correct? And this value can only be found out. This is the minimum point of the graph. This value can only be found out by calculus. So calculus is required for it. No, Jatin, range will not be all real numbers. In the present example, which I have taken, the range is probably from minus 5 to infinity. Okay, but minus 5 because you're seeing the graph, right? If you have not used any kind of a mathematics on that, and nobody has told you any graph of it, range will be difficult thing to find out in such cases. So please remember. No, it is not all positive real numbers. Again, let me tell you here, this particular example itself violates that. It is from negative 5 to infinity in this case, but it depends on case to case. So what is going to happen in case of a biquadratic polynomial? Listen to this very, very clearly. A biquadratic polynomial will have a minima somewhere. It will have a minimum point somewhere, like the one which we saw in the GeoGebra graph. Okay. And for this, we require calculus. Okay, calculus is required for this. You cannot find it out without the use of calculus. You have to find dy by dx. We have to put the slope to zero. We have to solve that equation and get our position of the minima and the value of the minima. So for range, you need calculus. So it will be from some minimum value to plus infinity. But for this minimum value, we need calculus. Okay. So in your school exams and your centum exams, we will not be asking you to find the range of a biquadratic polynomial, other than the few exceptional cases. For example, x to the power 4, you can answer, right? For x to the power 4, you know, the minimum point is 0, maximum point is infinity. So it goes from 0 all the way to infinity. But in general, we will not give you a complicated, or we will not give you a normal biquadratic polynomial to find the range, because without calculus, you cannot find it out. Okay. Yes. If you see the graph of the biquadratic polynomial, I'll just show you back again. There are two values here, right? So as you can see, there are two values over here. One is here and other is here. And there is one, you can say, peak over here, this point. Okay. So how do you find the position of the lowest valley without calculus? You cannot do that. Okay. Both are minimum points only. Both are called local minimum points only, but without calculus, we will not be able to find it out. So to answer your question, sir, if there are two values or dips, both have different minimum, but yes. So we have to see which is the more minimum of the two, which is the lowest of the two. And then we have to decide the range of the graph. So a good news is that we will not be asking you, in fact, in your school also, they will not be asking you for the range of this, okay? Because you require calculus, and calculus has not been taught to you. But don't worry, as when the calculus will be taught to you, you will not be spared. Questions coming from questions based on finding range on biquadratic polynomials, then will start coming for your exams and tests. Okay. So this is the story when your leading coefficient is positive. Let's talk about when your leading coefficient is negative. The analysis is more or less the same. In fact, you will be also able to do this analysis on your own. So when your leading coefficient is negative, when your x becomes very, very large, remember f of x will become negatively very, very large. And same will be holding true even if your x is negatively very, very large. So whether your x goes to infinity or minus infinity, because the leading coefficient is negative, ax to the power 4 will always be a negatively large quantity. This basically indicates that the way the graph will be oriented will be something like this. The end arms will be facing downwards like this. In between some peaks and valleys will happen. So in between some peaks and valleys will happen, which basically I will not be, you know, in a position to comment till I know the exact function. Okay. So what I want to say here is that when x becomes very, very large, y will become negatively very, very large. And x becomes negatively very, very large, y will still become negatively very, very large. Okay. Let me show you one of the cases on one of the cases here. The same graph. Now I will take my x leading coefficient to be a negative number. Maybe let's say negative 2. Okay. There you go. See the way this graph has behaved. By the way, I should not put such a large number because it is killing away the valleys. Maybe I'll just put a negative sign. Let's see what happens. Okay, it's just taken a turn. Okay, I'll just give another version of it. I mean, the agenda is fine. The agenda is fulfilled that both the arms are going towards minus infinity. But I will try to put a better picture over here. Let's say I'll put a plus sign. Okay. Yeah. See this. So what is this graph trying to show you? This graph is trying to show you that as x becomes positively large, this function goes down all the way till negative infinity. Okay. And when this value of x becomes negatively very, very large, still it goes to negative infinity. Okay. In between, there are some peaks and valleys. Now, what do you look at the graph and tell me, what is the domain of the graph? You'll say the domain of the graph is no different. It is still minus infinity to infinity. But what is the range of the graph? You say for range, I need to know this value, right? So this is the max point of the graph. Min is anyways negative infinity. Right. So in such case, to find out the max, you need calculus. Calculus is again required. Without calculus, you will not be able to move even a single inch in this particular concept. Okay. So coming back to this, please note that the domain in this case. Just a second, guys. I think I need to change my digital pen. It is giving me a lot of issues. So I'll just get a different one. Yeah. So domain here will be, again, all real numbers. Ayo, what is this? Yeah, all real numbers, or you can say minus infinity to infinity. And range here would be from a max position, or you can say minus infinity to a max position. And this max position, please don't start writing max in your paper, right? Because this is something which will be coming out from calculus. So you require calculus for it. No, don't worry. Your teachers will not ask you for range question based on this. Maybe they will ask only the domain question. Okay. So even I'm not, I know, talking about what will be the max position over here. Okay. So one of the peaks will be the maximum position depending upon which is more. Okay. So in this case, you will realize that the conclusion is, the summary of this is, for any, let me conclude it. For any biquadratic polynomial for any biquadratic polynomial, the domain will be always, okay, domain will always be minus infinity to infinity, and range would be, please note this down, if A is positive, it will be from a minimum position to infinity, and if A is negative, it will be from negative infinity to a maximum position, okay, where minimum and maximum values can be figured out from calculus, where min and max are obtained from the use of calculus. Okay, we cannot find it without, you know, we cannot see, sketching is anyways a difficult task. Okay, even if you want to apply mathematics to get it, we cannot find it without knowing calculus. Is this fine? Now I can go on and on. I can go to a pentic, I can go to a degree 6, degree 7, degree 8, degree 9, but let me conclude here about polynomials. So what we have learned about polynomial is the following things. First of all, have you all copied this down? Do you have any question that you would like me to answer here? All fine. Yes, please copy it down. I'm giving you time. Just let me know done once you're done. Okay. All right. So let's do a quick recap. We started our discussion with in the polynomials from a constant polynomial. So a constant polynomial was basically a horizontal line extending all the way from minus infinity to infinity. So domain was all real numbers, correct? Keep an eye on the domain and the range part. Okay. And range was a singleton set, which was equal to the value of the constant, right? So f of x equal to 3, range is a singleton set 3, correct? Then we extended our learning to linear polynomial. Linear polynomials are basically lines which extend all the way from minus infinity to infinity, both along the x-axis and along the y-axis. Hence, your domain was all real numbers, range was also all real numbers. When it came to quadratic, domain was all real numbers, but range was from a minimum to a maximum position of infinity. That means minimum vertex position to infinity if your A was positive, and maximum position to minus infinity if A was negative. And that maximum minimum positions were nothing but the y coordinate of the vertices, which you easily found out by use of the formula minus d by 4a, right? Remember the last class? Today I started talking about cubic polynomials. Here also we realize that domain and range both will be from minus infinity to infinity. But when it came to biquadratic, again, we basically got domain as minus infinity to infinity, but for the range, we got the minimum maximum problems. Okay. And these minimum maximum things that you can see on your screen, they're obtained by the use of calculus, right? So the trend here, or the pattern that you would notice here, is that, so let's do a conclusion with respect to polynomials. For any polynomial, let me write it down. For any polynomial, the domain is all real numbers. The domain is always all real numbers. So you can try any polynomial existing in the world, domain will always be all real numbers. That means polynomials are such machines which you can feed anything. Okay. They will eat anything they want. Okay. So whatever number you want to feed into a polynomial, they will be more than happy to accept it. Right. But when it comes to range, just a second, guys. I think, can you all see me? Am I visible to you all? Okay, because now I have to, there's just a small power cut. Just give me a second. Yeah. Yeah. But when it comes to range, please note that for odd degree polynomial, range is given as all real numbers again. But for even degree polynomials, your range is given from the max to the minimum position if your leading coefficient is positive. So if your leading coefficient is positive, then range is going to be, from a minimum to a infinity. And if your leading coefficient is negative, your range is going to be from, from minus infinity to a max position. The only exception to this, even that is not an exception, the only even degree polynomial where you can find this min and max easily is your quadratic polynomial, right? So let me write down here. For quadratic polynomial, min and max are easy to find out, right? Because that doesn't require you actually to go to calculus. Okay. So for quadratic polynomial, your min will be and max will be minus d by 4a. So for this, you do not need the use of calculus. Where you will use calculus? You will need calculus when you have a higher degree polynomial, like degree 4, degree 6, degree 8. For quadratic, you don't need a calculus. So this page beautifully summarizes domain and range concept for any polynomial function existing in this world. So what does it say? Number one, it says that for any polynomial, domain is always all real numbers. Blindly, you can say without any second thought. But when it comes to range, it actually depends whether you are dealing with odd degree polynomial or even degree polynomial. So for odd degree polynomial, range is also all real numbers. But when it comes to even degree polynomial, you need to basically see what is the leading coefficient. Is it positive? Then it will be some from minimum value to some infinity. If it is leading coefficient is negative, it will be going from minus infinity to some maximum value, where this minimum and maximum value are found from calculus. So use of calculus is required. Okay. The only gentle case, the only sober case, I would say, the only simple case, I would say, in such case is your quadratic polynomial, where you do not need any calculus. Min and max can easily be obtained by this formula, minus d by 4a. D is the discriminant. Everybody knows about it. Is this set in your mind? Because this is going to be for there with you for the next 2 years. If you have any doubt, any question, please get it addressed now itself. Okay. Understood. Now, let me ask somebody to summarize whatever I said. Any volunteers, by the way? Let me not take the name. Any volunteer who would like to conclude this polynomial domain range concept? Anybody? Harshita, would you like to conclude this? Harshita, you're there? No, Harshita is not there. Achintya, would you like to conclude this? You have to unmute yourself.
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes. Please go ahead, Achintya. Yes.
Yes, sir. So for any polynomial, the domain is the set of all real numbers.
Very good.
And for range, if it's an odd degree polynomial, then the range is a set of all real numbers.
Very good.
And in an even degree polynomial, if the leading coefficient is positive, then the range is from a minima to positive infinity.
And how will you find this minima?
Using calculus.
Use of calculus, which we'll deal later on. But for a quadratic, you know how to find it?
Yes, sir. By minus
d by 4a. Very good. Go ahead.
And if the leading coefficient is less than zero, that is negative, then the range will be from minus infinity to a maxima.
Beautiful. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Achintya. Okay, is it clear now, everybody? Fine. So with this now, we will be moving on to rational functions. So in our list of functions, if you recall, in the last class, I had given you that we will be discussing few types of functions in our discussion. Under algebraic function, we have successfully finished off polynomials. Now we are going to talk about domain range, and here and there we'll sketch graphs also, but graphing is not very important as of now, as domain and range is. We are going to talk about rational functions. Rational functions. What are rational functions? Does anybody remember? What is a rational function? So when do you call a function as a rational function? Any idea? Anybody? There is an example of a rational function, but see, if I say, what is a human being? Akhil. I know I'm a human being, but there can be many more human beings. So how do you define a rational function? Rational function is nothing but a function which is expressed as a polynomial divided by another polynomial. So here P and Q both are polynomials only. Okay. Let me give you a few examples. What happened to my polynomials? Yeah. So some examples which I can cite for this, easy ones. 1 by x is what Arya is saying. So as you can see, 1 is a polynomial, degree 0 polynomial. X is a polynomial, degree 1 polynomial. So this could be an example. You could have x minus 2 by x plus 4. This could be an example. You could have something like x plus 1 by x square minus 3x plus 6. I mean, I'm just taking some polynomials here. So these are all examples of polynomial function. Okay. So now we are going to start talking about the domain range. And in some cases, we'll be also looking into their graph. But graph is not very important for us. Okay. Rational functions, which are made up of. So let me take few cases for you. The first case I'll be talking about such rational functions, which are made up of a constant. Let me write something like constant divided by a linear polynomial. A linear polynomial. Okay. And to a certain extent, we will also see their graphs as well. So let's say I take this example. Maybe 2 divided by 3x minus 5. Okay. Now, if you remember your transformation of graphs concept, which we learned in the bridge course, let us try to make the graph of this particular rational function. And when we have made the graph, we will also look into the domain and the range of the graph. Okay. And then we'll try to come to some particular theory related to it. So for this particular function, if you see, let me initiate with my basic graph of f of x is equal to 1 by x. Okay. Now all of you, please pay attention. 1 by x graph, you had only done in your bridge course, it's going to be a rectangular hyperbola like this. Okay. So these are the two arms of the same graph. Okay. Now, all of you, please note that at the back of the mind, I have this particular thing running on, which I have not explicitly written over here. So if I write this function like this, everybody's fine with that. You can simplify this, you'll get the same answer back. Okay. So at the back of the mind, I need to reach this destination. So for reaching this destination, I will do some set of transformations. Okay. Right, Satyajit, we'll come to that. Okay. Now everybody please pay attention. So this is the graph of 1 by x. Now, if I ask you, how would the graph of 2 by 3 divided by x will look like, or 2 by 3 x will look like? See, the multiplication of 2 by 3 just tries to scale the graph by a factor of 2 by 3. Position wise, it is not going to get disturbed. It is not going to move right or left or up or down. Okay. So I'll just show you how 2 by 3 will affect the graph on GeoGebra so that you get a good idea about it. So I'm now going to mute this graph and I'm going to make y is equal to 1 by x. Okay, this graph everybody can see, correct? There you go. Yeah, now just watch carefully. I'm now going to multiply 2 by 3 to this. So 2 divided by 3x. There you go. Okay, not much of a change, no shifting here and there. It's just going to scale up on the same place. Okay, at the very same place, it's going to scale down. In fact, scale down by a factor of 2/3. Okay, so overall, if I go to this graph, multiplying with 2 by 3 doesn't have a substantial change in the shape of the graph. So maybe it is slightly more puchku. Okay, it will puchko 5 more. Okay, not much of a change. Okay, now everybody please pay attention. Now the third step, I'm going to replace my x with x minus 5 by 3. Now for the people who were not in the bridge course with us, I hope when you're looking at it, you may be finding things slightly unknown to you. Okay. In that case, please ask relevant questions. Okay. So now who will tell me? Arya will tell me. Arya, when you change x with x minus something and that something is positive, what happens to the graph? Bataye, tell me.
It moves to the left. X is positive or negative?
X is positive, moves to the left. Just give me a second. I think my volume of my speaker is. Ayo. Yes. Does it move to the left or does it move to the right?
Right.
It moves to the right, yes.
Okay. By 5/3.
Exactly, it moves by 5/3. Very good. So what will happen? This arm will move 5/3 units like this. That means it will become in this shape. Okay. Please note that this means your vertical asymptote will now become x equal to 5/3. Right? Now, looking at this graph, you tell me what should be the domain and what should be the range of this particular function. You say, sir, domain, I can see the graph extending all the way from minus infinity to plus infinity, but only one value it doesn't take, which is 5/3, right? Somebody was saying, sir, it cannot take 5/3. I think Satyajit, absolutely yes. Correct. So this guy can take all real numbers except 5/3. Are you getting my point? At 5/3, this function will be undefined. It doesn't know what to do because your denominator will become zero. As you can see, this guy will become a zero. Are you getting my point? Now, what about the range? What about the range? If you see, the range here will be all real numbers except zero. As you can see, your y value is not becoming zero. It is stopping below zero and starting from slightly above it. See, all the way from minus infinity is coming, stopping just before zero. Before zero means it is not touching the x-axis. And then again, it's starting slightly above x-axis and going all the way to plus infinity. Yes or no? Okay. So this is the domain and the range of the graph. Now, many people ask me this question, sir, does it mean I have to draw a graph every time to find domain and range? No. I will tell you now a way by which you can solve this type of question without sketching a single line. That means domain and range can be found out without having you to sketch the graph. Okay. I'm sure most of you would have done this in school as well. So we will take that approach in the next 2 minutes. But before that, any question anybody has, please do ask, because I'm going to go to the next screen. Any questions? And then we'll take a few questions based on that. Don't worry. Clear? Any questions, any concerns? Keep it. No doubt. Now, Arya, try speaking something. I have increased the volume of my system.
Hi, sir.
Yeah, hi.
Hi.
Okay. Now, we will move on to a theory based on this. Okay. So, how to find domain and range for a function of this nature, a constant divided by a linear polynomial. And later on, I will complicate it. As you know, my nature is to complicate things slowly. Okay, I will never do it initially. I'll start with very basics and then I will complicate it. Okay. Okay, now all of you, please pay attention. When you have, let's say, take the same question. When you have this function, f of x or y equal to, I mean, doesn't matter whether you say f of x or y. The function was 2 divided by, I think, 5x, 3x minus 5, right? If I'm not mistaken, 3x minus 5. Okay. Now, please note, in such cases, our domain is all real numbers except those values of x which will make the denominator go 0. Okay, in this case, your denominator is 3x minus 5. Okay, so in general, if I have to write it, so if you have, let's say, a constant divided by q of x, so your domain is going to be all real numbers except minus sign shows except, okay, except those values of x which will make the denominator polynomial become 0. So whatever values are making your denominator polynomial 0, remove them from all real numbers. So whatever will be obtained, that will be your domain. Got the point? So this is without using graph. You can straight away go to the domain and you can answer this question. So here, if I try to solve this question, then basically I will be removing from all real numbers that value of x which will make 3x minus 5 become 0. So which value makes 3x minus 5 become 0? You'll say, sir, 5 by 3. So remove 5 by 3. Done. This is my answer for the domain. Clear? Any question, any concerns, do let me know. No doubt. Okay. Now what about range? Guys, few things before I start finding about range. Number one, finding range is slightly more complicated than finding domain. That thing you have to, you will learn in, you know, after solving a substantial amount of question. Number two, without domain, there is no existence of range. The second point is very important. I've seen people directly jumping for finding the range. Even if the question says find range, no domain, you have to still find the domain. Get this clear. Even if the question says find range only, you still have to find the domain. There is no existence of range without domain. If you don't know your input, how would you decide your output? Range is what? Range is output, na? Domain is input. Agar input hi nahi pata hai, to output kaise pata karoge? Are you getting my point? This is a very, very strong statement which I am making here, because the last 12, 13 years of my teaching experience, I have seen people misusing this rule left, right, and center. Domain nahi nikalte, range pe chale jate seedhe. No. First domain. Then when you know your domain, then accordingly you will act to find out the range. I don't know how it has been taught to you in the school, but I personally am a very strong supporter of this concept that without the domain, there is no existence of range. Domain decides what is the range. Okay. For example, I'll give you a very simple instance. You may find it very trivial. Let's say I give you this question. There is a function which is defined like this. Okay. Very simple question. Tell me the range of this function. So this function works from set to all real numbers. Tell me the range of this function. Can you write it down on your chat box? Tell me the range of this function. I know I'm asking you a very simple question, but still I have a feeling there is a you can say hunch that somebody is going to give me a wrong answer for this. Right. Nobody is writing. Everybody is quiet. Excellent, Jatin. As expected. I mean, as expected, you have got it right. But trust me, many people will get it wrong also. I mean, God forbid it should happen. Everybody should give me the right answer. You know, 99% of the janta initially will say, sir, it's a polynomial of degree one. Range is all real numbers, minus infinity to infinity. No. Watch out the domain. This is the domain, my dear. How can you expect an infinity to come out? How can you expect 100 to come out when your inputs are only limited to 2, 3, 4? Are you getting my point? So if you have a blind eye towards the domain, you will not be able to find the range correctly. Let me tell you. So in this case, as rightly said by Jatin, range will be the values of f of x only for these three values. So when you put a 2, this will give you a 3. When you put a 3, you will get a 5. When you put a 4, you will get a 7. That's it. This is your range. Over. Story is over. Okay, this is your answer. Don't start writing all real numbers just because there was a theory given to you that for a linear polynomial or an odd degree polynomial, your range will be all numbers from minus infinity to infinity. That is fine. That is under the assumption that your domain is minus infinity to infinity. But if I cut short my domain like this, range will also get cut short. Agar aap machine ko 2 pilaoge ya 3 daloge or 4 hi daloge, only these three things can be put into the machine. Machine will accordingly give you the answer. No. How will your machine give you 5 lakh and 1 crore and all? Right, Achintya. That's the, you know, so many people have a blind eye towards this fact. So please be careful. Anyways, coming to range part. So range has no existence without domain. So how do you find range in this case? Now for range, what I do is, whatever is the function given to me, I will rewrite it once again. I will make X the subject of the formula. Why I make X the subject of the formula? Because X is your input and I know everything about the input. Okay. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to write X in terms of Y, or I'm going to make X the subject of the formula. How to do that? Very simple. Just multiply this to the left. Okay. Take your terms like this on the other side. Okay. I hope I have not. Yeah. So your X will become this. Okay. Your X will become this. Right? Any doubt till this step? No doubt. This is just a simple, you know, equating it to Y and getting X in terms of Y. There should not be any doubt with respect to this. Any doubt, any questions, please do let me know. No doubt. Any question anybody has? Okay. Now, what is the restriction on the domain? The restriction on the domain is your X should be all real numbers except 5 by 3. So can I say, since this is the restriction on X, the same restriction should be on this guy as well, because this is a representation of X only. So this guy should also be all real numbers except 5 by 3. Yes or no? Yes or no? Since both are representation for X only, whether you write X or whether you write 2 plus 5y by 3y, if your X belongs to this interval, so should 2 plus 5y by 3y also belong to the same interval. Okay. Now, this guy will anyways not take 5 by 3. Why? Let's check. So in the side, I will make a small calculation. I will try to put this as, I'll try to put this as 5/3. See what will happen. Okay. When I do that, you will realize that it will become 2 + 5y = 5y, which means 2 = 0, which is not possible. So this guy anyways will not become 5/3. That is for sure. Okay. You may try to test it out. You may try to, you know, put it as 5/3. You will get a shock of your life. You will see that, oh, 2 is becoming = 0, which is not possible. But all I want to check is that this guy must be a real number now. So if you want this to be real number, the only restriction that you need to honor over here is that this denominator should not become 0. Exactly. So if you want this to be a real number, it means your 3y should not be 0 or your y should not be 0. That's it. There's any value you put, it is fine with it. It is happily take any value of y. Put 5, put 100, put negative 2 lakhs. It is happy to take those values. But what it is scared of is, don't put a 0 in y, because the denominator will vanish because of that. The denominator will become 0 because of that. So hence, we say, since y cannot be 0, and y is what? Y is the output. Y is the output, right? Output is the range. So your range cannot be 0. So what we say is that range can be any real number except 0. So here you see, I have found out the answer for domain and range without making any graph. Is this fine? Is this clear? Any questions here, anybody? Any questions? Okay. So should we now scale it up? Let us scale this concept to talk about those rational functions which have a linear bilinear. Yes. I'll give more examples. Don't worry. You want of the same type? Let's do of the same type. We'll take one more of the same type. No problem, Arya. We'll take one more. So let's do a small question. Find the domain and range of this function. Let me put 4/(3 − 2x). Everybody do this question and give me a response on the chat box. Excellent. Domain is very easy to find out. Yeah, correct, Vishal. Good. Ashintya. Jatin. Very good. Very good, Tanvi. So Tanvi has given both the answers. Others also, please do this, guys and girls. Let me tell you, this concept is very important for your school as well, right? Everybody wants to do well in school exams, at least, right? UTs, semester exams, these type of questions definitely will come. Definitely. Very good, Arnav. Okay, Jatin. Should we discuss it now? Anybody wants more time? Domain, not exactly, Arya. You made a small mistake. See, for domain, as I already told you, let's discuss it, everybody. Some of you are not very confident, so I'll just do it once again. Domain is all real numbers except those values which will make the denominator become zero. Okay. So if you solve this part, you'll end up getting 2x is equal to 3, so x is equal to 2 by 3. So it means your answer will be all real numbers except, sorry, I made a small 3 by 2. Yeah, sorry, 3 by 2. So this will be all real numbers except 3 by 2. Okay, not 0. Got it? Okay, so this will become the domain of your given function. No worries with domain. Everybody got it right. Domain is the easiest part. Okay. Now coming to range. Now that I have known what is my domain, so I know what all I can input in my function. Let's try to figure out what is range. Range means what is the value that y can take, right? So if I equate this to y, so what is the extent I can choose values for y? That is your output. So here again, I will make x the subject of the formula. So basically, this is a simple operation. So I can say 2xy is equal to 3y minus 4. So x is equal to 3y minus 4 by 2y. Now, since your x is all real numbers except 3 by 2, it implies 3y minus 4 by 2y should also be all real numbers except 3 by 2. Correct? Yes or no? But 3 by 2 anyways, it will not take. So there's no, I mean, this is not a relevant thing for it because see, it cannot take 3 by 2. Try to equate it to 3 by 2. I'll just do it over here. If I equate it to 3 by 2, you would realize you'll end up seeing something very weird, which means minus 4 is equal to 0. Not possible. Okay, so anyways, this guy will not be 3 by 2. So only thing I need to take care is that it should be real. If you want this to be real, this guy should not be 0. That means y should not be 0. That's it. So this means the range of this function is all real numbers except 0. Same answer as what we got for the previous one. Is this clear? And everybody, those who made a mistake, is it now fine with you? Okay. Now let me go to a slightly more complicated case. So our concept will get more refined as we take more complicated cases. Is this fine, everybody? Any questions? So domain is everything except 3 by 2. Range is everything except 0. So if you see the graph, I will draw it over here for you. Let me mute these guys. So I think my function was y is equal to, what was it? 4 by 3 minus 2x. Nah? 4 by 3 minus 2x. 4 divided by 3 minus 2x. There you go. So you can see that x equal to 3 by 2 will become its vertical asymptote. There you go. That means this function will never become a 3 by 2. The moment it tries to take 3 by 2, it will become undefined. Okay. And range, if you see, it's coming all the way from minus infinity to little below zero, and then from little above zero to infinity. Right. Just the denominator should not be zero. We will reach that conclusion in some time as I take more and more situations. Okay. So now I'm going to take up a case. where you have a functional equation, sorry, you have a rational function. I was teaching functional equation to your seniors and I started using functional equation. So now you have a rational function where you have a linear polynomial by another linear polynomial. Okay. So basically, it's a case where your P and Q both are linear polynomials only. Let's take an example. Let's say something like this, x minus 1 by x plus 3. Okay. So you can see here in this case, both your numerator polynomial and denominator polynomial are linear functions or linear polynomials. Okay. Now, how do we find domain in such case? Now, for the domain, the concept is no different. So let me call them by the name of P of x and Q of x, and both of them are linear only. So both of them are linear polynomials only. So in such cases also, the concept of domain is no different. So your domain in this case will be, again, all real numbers except those values of x, which will make the denominator go zero, simple as that. So in general, if I have to write it, okay, domain is going to be all real numbers except those values which will make the polynomial below, that is the denominator polynomial, become zero. So nothing different from what we did in the previous case, nothing different, same thing here also. Okay, because see, both the guys are polynomial, right? They don't have any problem taking any input. We have just now seen polynomials are functions which you can feed anything you want, right? Right? They are not perturbed by any input you give it to them. But they're only, as a team, they're only perturbed when you give something which makes the denominator become zero. Because if that happens, the whole thing becomes undefined. So if the base becomes zero, collapse, gaya, gir jayega. Okay, so it'll become undefined expression. So they're fine, give anything to them. Okay, I'm happy with anything, but don't give me anything which will make the denominator go zero, because then this expression will falter. Is this fine? Okay, so in this case, when you solve this question, your answer will be, the answer to this question will be all real numbers except negative 3. Okay. This is going to be the answer for the domain. Now range also, the idea is more or less the same. Okay. Nothing will be different much. So for range, same thing. We will first try to write X in terms of Y. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to write X in terms of Y, same approach. So multiply it. Okay. So XY plus 3Y, X minus 1. Let's make X the subject of the formula. And if I'm not mistaken, X will be 1 minus Y is equal to 3Y plus 1. So X will be 3Y plus 1 upon 1 minus Y. Okay. Now, since X belongs to all real numbers except negative 3. It means same will be true for this guy also. Okay, this guy also will be all real numbers except negative 3. But negative 3 it anyways won't take. Why? Let's see. Negative 3, anyways, this guy won't take. Because if you equate this to negative 3, see what will happen. You'll get the shock. It becomes negative 3 plus 3y. So that means you're trying to say 1 is equal to minus 3, which is not possible. So this guy anyways won't take negative 3. Nahi lega, kabhi nahi lega. Right? Because that is not mathematically possible. But what it should take is a real number other than minus 3. So if you want this guy to be real number, what is one condition that you need to fulfill? Think as if you're finding the domain of this function itself. So what is the domain of this guy itself? You say y should not be 1. Exactly, Achintya. You'll say, sir, it is fine with anything you feed to it, but it will not be fine the moment your y is such that your denominator becomes a zero. That means y cannot be a one, right? And indirectly, you have basically written your range. So your range will be all real numbers except one. Is this fine? So this is your range. This is your domain. Any questions here, anybody? Any questions? Okay. Would you like to see the graph also? Would you like to see the graph? Let's see the graph. Could you scroll a bit to the other side? Other side means to the left of the screen? This way? Other way, we are at the leftmost part only. Yeah. I think this contains the most amount of information. Done. Okay, we'll see the graph also for this. Let's see the graph. Yeah. Can somebody dictate the function to me? What was it? Anybody can?
X minus 1 by x plus 3.
X minus 1 by x plus 3. Thank you. There you go. Okay. Now here, if you see, this function will take any x other than minus 3. So x equal to minus 3 will be like a vertical asymptote. See here. Got it? And this guy will take any value other than 1. So y equal to 1 output can never be achieved. As you can see, y equal to 1 is a horizontal asymptote. Okay. Is it fine? Jatin has a question. In f of x, can we say that the value for which the numerator is 0 is the range? The value for which the numerator is 0 is the range. No, not necessarily.
No, sir. That was a typo, sir. Actually, what I was saying was, it's not included in the range, that value. Like, if you take the example x minus 1 by x plus 3, now x minus 1 is there. If x in the numerator is 1, then it becomes 0, right?
Okay, maybe in this example, it is trying to give you a feel like that, but...
So one shouldn't be included in the range. That's what I was saying. When the denominator is 0, won't be included in the domain. Because while we are making it in terms of y, what we do is cross multiply it, right? So the numerator of the f of x becomes the denominator when we take it in terms of x.
We'll see more examples. Maybe let's say in the next example, we get some kind of hint like that. We'll see it. Okay, we'll see that particular aspect of it. But actually, it is not that. Actually, it's the limit of this which it cannot take. You have learned limits, right? But you have not learned a case where the limit is when your x is becoming very, very large. When your x becomes very, very large, this answer is going to be a 1. That value it cannot take because x becoming very, very large itself is not possible. Because you're trying to say x becoming infinity. Infinity is not achievable. That value is removed from the range. Right now you're seeing here minus 1, right? If I make it 2, then range will not include 2. If I make a 2 over here, if I make this guy 2, let me just write it. I will remove it after this. Then your range will not include 2. Let's take an example. Let's take the same example. Find the domain and range of this function. As I told you, I will put a 2. Okay, rest everything is same. Denominator was, I believe, x plus 3 only, right? Okay, let's try to solve this. In fact, I will also solve along with you so that we don't devote a lot of time for this question. So for domain, it is pretty simple. Domain, you will say, sir, all real numbers except those values of x, which will make the denominator vanish, right? So only minus 3 makes it vanish. So the outcome of it is x equal to minus 3. So from all real numbers, remove minus 3. That will be your domain. So this is your domain answer. No doubt about this. Everybody is fine with this, isn't it? Now, let us find out the range. For range, process is same as that what we took in the previous example. Okay. Let's cross multiply. Okay. And let's make x the subject of the formula. Okay. So x becomes 3y plus 1 upon 2 minus y. Clear? Now, since your x is all real numbers other than minus 3, since this belongs to all real numbers other than minus 3, it implies even this guy should be all real numbers other than minus 3. Correct? Now, minus 3, anyways, it won't take, that we already know. I don't want to, you know, waste time doing the same thing again and again. But if you want it to be real, at least you need to ensure that this guy is not 0. That means y should not be 2. So what did I say, Ajatin? So your range will not include 2 into it. It's not about the numerator point becoming 0, right? So this case is basically linked to your understanding of limits, which still not to the requirement. We will complete our limits chapter officially when we start it in our regular program. After that, you will be able to make sense out of it. Is this fine? Okay, now time to complicate it even further, right? Time to complicate it even further. And now what will happen if I put linear on top and quadratic in the denominator? Okay. While domain is easy for that, range will require another important prerequisite for it. And what is that prerequisite? I will talk about it before I give you any question on this. So now we're talking about domain and range for such rational functions where the denominator is a quadratic, okay, and numerator could be linear or constant, anything linear or constant, okay, but this has a prerequisite. Before I start talking about domain and range concept, domain is easy. Domain, I'm not, this prerequisite is not for domain. This prerequisite is for range. Okay. So before we take a question on range, there is a small prerequisite. I should not say small. This is actually a substantially important concept for us. So that small prerequisite is, you must know wavy curve sine scheme. Naam to suna hi hoga. Also called method of interval. Okay. I'm sure your school teachers would have done this. Okay. Whether you were aware of it or not, she definitely would have done it. Okay. Because without this, you will have a problem in solving at least some questions based on domain and range with respect to this. Now, what is this concept? Have you done this wavy curve sine scheme in school? Anybody? Naphlis would have done it. What about Rajaji Nagar students? Anybody remembers vaguely? Your teacher making a number line, putting plus minus signs on it. Any kind of approach like this was done in school? Yes, no, maybe. Yeah, now you remember. Okay, what she did was actually this guy, wavy curve sine scheme. So what is this sine scheme? Let us try to understand this. Okay, now wavy curve sine scheme basically is a method. This is a method which helps to solve rational function inequalities. Okay, so this is a function by which we can, this is a method by which we can solve something like this. I'll just draw and just write a generic expression. X minus alpha 1, X minus alpha 2, da 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 da, till X minus alpha p. And let's say they have some powers k1, k2, da 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 da, kp, divided by X minus beta 1, X minus beta 2. They may have some powers also. I will write it down. Let's say L1, L2 till LQ. Okay. And it helps you to solve these inequalities like greater than equal to zero or greater than zero or less than equal to zero or less than zero. Okay. Any of these four type of inequalities involving a rational function to the left and zero on the right can be solved by wavy curve sine scheme. Okay. To explain this, I will take an example. It is best understood by an example. So how does wavy curve sine scheme help us to solve such kind of examples, such kind of questions? Okay. So let's take an example. Let us say I want you to solve this inequality. I hope I'm not taking very heavy figures. Sir, such a high figure you are taking. Ayyo. Let's say I make it to the power of 11. Okay. Let's say I want to solve this inequality. Okay. What is the meaning of solving an inequality? What do you understand when somebody says solve this inequality? It simply means for what values of x or for what interval of x will this particular inequality is met. Okay. So for this, I'm going to use wavy curve sine scheme, also called as methods of interval. Listen to this very, very carefully because it is not only important for your domain range concept, but is going to be equally important when you do application of derivatives with me next year. Next year, almost at the same time, you will be studying application of derivatives in mathematics. And there you will realize that in the application of derivatives concept, there is a concept of increasing, decreasing functions or monotonic functions. There you will use this wavy curve sine scheme again. And that time, if somebody says, sir, what was that scheme? I forgot. Then it will be very difficult for me to revisit this. Okay. So put your ears like this, eyes focus on the screen. Listen to each and every word which I'm going to say very, very carefully. Okay. Ready, everybody? All are attentive? Cool. Let's go for it. So wavy curve sine scheme, as I already told you, works under two important situations. Both the situations should be met. Number one, your left-hand side term that you see over here, this should be in a factorizable format. Okay. And the right side number that you see over here should be a zero. Then only wavy curve sine scheme, which I'm going to talk about in a few minutes, that will work, else it will not work. So if you have a non-zero number over here, so whatever approach I'm going to tell you, that will not work. Okay. So how will I make use of this method? So you have to bring the one to the other side and do some recalculations. Okay. Second thing, it will not work if you are not able to factorize this rational function, because everything is a game of factor over here. So wavy curve sine scheme will work only when this rational function is factorizable. That is, this condition is met and the right side should be a zero. This inequality could be anything. It doesn't matter whether greater than is equal to, whether greater than, whether less than equal to. No problem with that. The only these two conditions must be there for you to start the process. Okay. So if you are able to figure out that any of the two situations is not met, wavy curve is not going to be very helpful. Okay. It's not going to be helpful. You have to start looking for, you know, ways to make it to that form. Anyways, so what is this method? All of you, please listen to this very carefully. This method says, step number one, make a number line. Everybody knows how to make a number line. Array, straight line, banado, number line. Okay. On that number line, write the zeros of every factor that you see in this rational expression, whether in the numerator or denominator, doesn't make a difference. So for every factor that you see, there will be a zero for that factor. Write it on the number line. For example, this guy x minus 1 cube, the zero of that particular expression will be 1. Everybody understand the meaning of zero of a factor, right? Zero of a factor is that number which will make that factor zero. Okay, so 1 will be a factor from there, right? So please put 1 on the number line. So I'll be putting 1 over here, let's say. Okay, Next, minus 2. Next, 3. Okay. By the way, I have put one more here, so I'll just put it somewhere else. Because I have to accommodate 0 also, I have to accommodate minus 1 also. Okay. So what I've done is, on a number line, I have plotted the zeros of each of these factors. So 1 I have plotted, see here, minus 2 I have plotted, 3 I have plotted, 0 I have plotted, because this guy is as good as x minus 0 to the power 6. If you want, you can write this in your mind like this, x minus 0 to the power 6. Okay, same as x to the power 6. And of course, minus 1, everything has been plotted. Okay, so first step is clear to everybody. Step number 1 is clear to everybody. Okay, step number 2 is where, let me not put numbers here because I would not require it. Step number 2 is we have to assign signs to these intervals that are created. As you can see on your screen, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 intervals created because of those 5 numbers, right? So those 5 numbers have basically broken down your real number line into 6 intervals. Now, what I need to do, I need to assign signs to those intervals. Now, what is that, sir? What is the meaning of assigning sign to these intervals? Very simple. Pay attention to what I'm going to say. Basically, what I'm trying to see is that in this interval, if I take any number, let's say I take this interval. Okay, this interval. Okay. In this interval, if I take any number, no matter how big you want to take, what is going to be the sign of this guy in that interval? The one which I am circling out. Okay. So I just need the sign. I don't need the value. Okay. So let me pick a number in that interval. Tell me anything which is more than 3. Anybody. Any number more than 3. Any number. 4. Let's say Achitya says 4. So if you put a 4 in place of x in this entire expression, what is the sign of the answer that you get? So you'll say, sir, 4 minus 1. Cube is positive, 4 plus 2 square is positive, 4 minus 3 to the power 5 is positive, 4 to the power 6 is positive, 4 plus 1 to the power 11 is positive. So the sign of the number that I will be getting here will be a positive quantity. So write a positive sign there. Okay. Now, rest for sure that if you take any number in that interval, so you took a 4, you take a 7, you take a 100, you take a 5 million, that answer will be a positive. You can check yourself. You can try to check yourself. Take any other number. Take 7, those who are saying 7. Take 100, if you want to take 100. This is the sign. Sign will be positive, for sure. Convince everybody. Are you convinced? Are you convinced? Everybody, yes. Okay, Ani Arya is convinced. What about others? Are you not convinced? Convinced. Okay, good. Now, once you have given a sign to this, listen to the next step. Very, very interesting step. Okay. Start moving towards the left. Start moving towards the left of this number line. Okay, so start moving towards the left. When you're moving left, you will see numbers coming your way. The very first number that you see is a 3, isn't it? 3 comes from which factor? 3 comes from which factor in this expression? You'll say, sir, 3 is coming from this factor, x minus 3 to the power 5. Okay. On that factor, see what is the parity of the power on it. Parity means whether it is even or odd. Okay. Here you see 5 is an odd number. If the power is odd, if the power of that factor is odd, then switch the sign from whatever you had on the right to the ulta on the left. For example, you had a plus, then switch the sign, it will become a minus. So this interval will become a minus. Got it? You can try to test this by choosing any value between 1 to 3. Let's say I pick up a 2. So 2, if I put in this expression, you will realize that you will end up getting a negative answer. How? Let's check. If I put a 2 here in the very first one, I'll be getting a positive answer. This will be also giving a positive answer, but this guy will give me a negative answer. This anyways will be positive, anyways will be positive. So overall, this expression will become a negative quantity. So this is what this negative sign basically shows. So these signs are basically showing what will be the sign of that particular rational function in that interval of x. And you can take any number between 1 to 3. You can check it out. You can take 1.2. You can take 1.8. You can take 2.6. Check it out. It will be negative only. Okay. I will tell you the reason for it. Don't worry, little later on. First, note down the rule. Now a question will arise, sir. What if that power was even? If that power was even, then retain the sign. Very important. Guys, please listen to this very, very carefully. Later on, don't ask me, sir, what used to happen for that case? What used to happen for that case? I will not be able to tell that time. So listen very, very carefully. If possible, when you want to see this recording again, please do that. Okay. Is it fine? Next. Next number that you see is a 1. 1 comes from which factor? You'll say, sir, 1 comes from x minus 1 factor. What is the parity of the power on that factor? You'll say, again, sir, odd number. If it is odd, then again, you will switch the sign from whatever you had to the opposite of it. So if you had a minus here, you will switch to plus. So switching of signs will happen. Switch means the other one. Okay, whatever you have written to the right, you switch the one, you switch that sign and write it in the next one. Is it clear? Okay, no doubt. Next number you see is a 0. 0 comes from this particular factor, and this factor has an even power on this. Even, what is the rule? Retain the sign. That means it was a plus, so retain a plus sign here. Clear? Clear? Any questions? Any questions? No, don't ask me why, because I will tell you anyways it later on. Okay. Next, minus 1 comes from this factor, which has again got an odd power on it. Odd means switch. So whatever was a sign here, switch it and make it negative. So if it was positive, make it negative. Had it been negative, then you would have made positive. Switching of the sign will happen. I hope you understand the meaning of the word switch. Okay. Next, minus 2 comes from this factor, which has got an even power on the top. Even means retain. So minus will remain minus. So what do you see on your screen is I have assigned signs to these intervals. Okay. Now this can help us answer this question very, very easily. But before I move on to finally writing the answer to this question, is there anybody who has not understood the meaning of odd means switch, even means retain? Odd is switch, even is retain. Odd means switch, even is retain. Anybody has any questions? Any doubt, any questions? I hope everybody is attentive. I'll take a lot of questions on this, huh? Okay, great. So if you have understood these two facts, then after that is just a logical conclusion of this particular problem. Now you want to write that interval where this particular rational function is greater than or equal to 0. So basically, write down those intervals where this function is either positive or equal to 0. So wherever you have written a positive sign, please mention those intervals like this. So I have mentioned positive sign here. You can see my pen hovering around it. So that interval, minus 1 to 0, please write it down. Okay. Note that I'm not putting any brackets around it as of now. I will put it eventually, but right now I'm not putting any bracket. Okay. Next interval is 0 to 1. That also I will write it down. And the last interval is 3 to infinity. So what I've done, I have written these all intervals one by one. Any doubt with respect to this? Any questions? Any custa? No custa. Okay. Now, ensure that while you are doing this, you have not missed out any x value for which this expression was even 0. So have I missed out 1? Check. No, 1 is already written. Have I missed out minus 2? Yes, I have missed out minus 2. So minus 2 you write separately over here. Okay. Next. Have I missed out three? No, three I've already written over it. Okay. So please do this particular thing first of all. Next, time to put brackets around these numbers. So what brackets I will put? Please listen to this very, very carefully. Minus one. Can I include minus one in my x value? Look at the expression carefully and tell me, can I include minus one? So should I put a round bracket or should I put a square bracket? What do you think? Arnav is saying, no, sir, you cannot put a minus one in your x value. Why? Because if you put a minus one, denominator will become zero. And that is like, you know, making it undefined. That is completely unacceptable, isn't it? So right, absolutely round brackets will come here because I don't want minus one to be taken by my x. If my x takes minus one, bhuchal aa jayega, right? Isn't it? Denominator will become zero. Expression will become undefined. Okay. Zero. Can I take zero? Can x can take zero? Tell me. Can it take zero? No, because x to the power six will become angry. You are making me zero. How can it be possible, right? So iske paas bhi round brackets. Okay. So zero is here also. So I put round brackets here also. Okay. One. Can I put one? You will say yes, sir. So one, you put square bracket because one can be taken by x. Why? Because at one, it will become zero. And zero is fine as per my inequality. Zero to chalega na. Zero is fine. Can I include three? You will say yes. Again, square bracket. Can I include infinity? Never, sir. Infinity, how will you include infinity? Okay, infinity can never be included. Okay. Now, what is this single guy doing? If there is a single guy, you put a curly bracket. Means that will become a singleton set. So while these are intervals, this guy is a singleton set. Okay. Now, what do I do with these four sets I have got? Take their union. So your answer is if your x belongs to any one of these or union of these sets, it will satisfy the inequality. So this is the answer to this question. This is the answer to this question. Okay. Achintya has a question. If two are left, then they will become set or they set as two singletons. Yeah. If two elements are left, they will become a set of just two elements. So that also will be put under a curly bracket only. Correct, Achintya. Okay. No. If you write it as minus two to minus infinity, first of all, you should never write it like this. Minus infinity should always be towards the left. When you are writing an interval, guys, I've seen this practice, wrong practice done by people. They will write the larger number to the left and smaller number to the right. No, smaller number will always be left. Larger number will always be right. So it'll always be minus one to zero, not zero to minus one. Okay. Anyways, to answer that question, Arya, you cannot do that because it is not an interval that you are including. You're only including one value of x. Ondu value, one value, not interval. Aita, got it? Okay. So now using the same sign, you can also find out where is this particular rational function less than equal to zero, less than zero, or greater than zero. Everything can be found out from this diagram. Okay, so even though you're trying to address only this question, but this diagram can help you solve all types of inequality, greater than, equal to, less than, equal to, greater than, less than, everything by looking at the sign diagram. Is this fine? Okay, now what is the reason for this particular sign? See, try to understand here. There is a hidden region which I will try to explain it in a very simple way. See, when you are writing, I'll just take a simple example. Let's say I'm writing something like this, x plus one, x minus one, the whole square. And let's say x minus three, the whole cube divided by x plus one to the power of four. Let's say I want to basically solve this inequality. I'm taking a lighter version. I don't want to take a bigger version like this. So let's try to understand what is the reason for that sign that I was putting. Okay, because many of you would be wondering, sir, why you are switching the sign for odd and why you are retaining the sign for even. I'm trying to answer that question. Okay, now listen to this. Pay attention. Let me take a simpler one here. I've taken two higher power. Let's say I take a simpler one. Okay, let's say I want to solve this. First of all, I would like to convert this to a polynomial inequality. So how do I do that? Can I take this guy on the other side and write it like this? Can I do that? Can I say this and this are same things? Can I say that? Yes, no, maybe. What do you think? No, I cannot do that. Okay, guys and girls, please, please, please let me tell you, this and this are different things. See, we all have this wrong conception in our mind. Of course, in junior classes, we are not told much about it. When somebody sees this or somebody sees this, he basically thinks this is as good as saying A is greater than or equal to zero. He thinks that this is same as this. No. You can't just take B on the other side and multiply it with zero and make it zero. See, I'll just give you a simple illustration where this particular thing fails. We all know that minus 1 by minus 2 is half, correct? Half is greater than or equal to 0. Nobody will deny it. It's a universal truth. Okay. Can I say minus half is greater than or equal to 0 just by taking this minus 2 on the other side? This will be wrong, no? Minus half is not greater than or equal to 0. It is lesser than 0. Correct. So we have a very wrong conception with respect to inequalities. But don't worry, I'll be taking care of inequalities in a separate chapter for you, which is called inequality theory of equations and inequalities. Okay, that is another chapter, which is quite a big one. So many of us, we have this wrong notion that we can take this quantity to the other side and vanish it. No, it all depends upon the sign of this number, whether it is positive or negative. So if your A by B is such that B is positive, let me write it here. B is positive. If B is positive, then you can convert this to A greater than or equal to zero. But if your B is negative, the same inequality will convert to A less than or equal to zero. So it will switch the sign. Are you getting my point? Okay. So till you know the sign of this number, whether it is positive or negative, you cannot take it to the other side because you do not know the fate of the inequality, whether it will be same inequality or whether it will switch. Okay. Anyways, so I cannot do this. This step is prohibited. Okay. So what can I do? Simple. As I told you, if your B is positive, then I can say A is greater than or equal to zero. So why don't we make our B positive by multiplying and dividing with X plus 1 itself, both in the numerator and denominator. Okay. So if I'm multiplying by the same number in the numerator and denominator, the fraction or the rational function is not affected, isn't it? Now I know this guy is positive. So you can send it to the other side and you can write it like this. So what has happened? I have converted it to a polynomial inequality. Okay. Now, think as if you have a graph like this. Okay. This is a biquadratic function, right? Biquadratic polynomial function. You already know biquadratic polynomial function. The end arms will be up in the air like this. Correct. So if you sketch this graph roughly, okay, now see what will happen. This graph is going to cut the x-axis or touch the x-axis at minus 1. 3 and plus 1. So these are the factors, as you can see. It is going to either touch the x-axis or cut the x-axis at minus 1, 3 or 1, isn't it? Now, all of you please pay attention. Since the arm is upwards, we know the end arm should be upwards. This is how the graph should look like. It will come down. I think I should draw it more vertical up like this. Yeah. So it'll come down. It will cut the x-axis at this point. Ayyo. Let me make it. Yeah. It will cut the x-axis at this point. It will return back. It will again cut the x-axis at 1. It will again return back. It will come and graze at 3 and go back again. So this is how the graph will be looking like. Now, many people ask me, sir, how do you know at 1 it is cutting past, minus 1 also it is cutting past, but 3 it is not touching and going back? See, it is because when you have an even power on a factor, then left and the right of that number, the sign is not going to be influenced. For example, if this number is a 3, okay, if you take 3.1, this expression will still be positive. If you take 2.9, that will still be positive. Are you getting my point? So what you draw while you are drawing this sign is actually you are drawing the position of the graph above or below the x-axis. So if it is above, it is positive. Okay, this is also above positive. So this is below, this is negative. This is above, it is positive. So when you assign the signs here in this particular number line, you're basically trying to make, you're trying to estimate whether the graph was above the x-axis in that region or below the x-axis in that region. So above or below will help you to know the sign of y, indirectly helping you to know the sign of this particular expression and indirectly helping you to solve this inequality. Are you getting the point? So this is that remote linkage to this concept. So it is, you know, dur se rishta nikal ke aa raha hai, right? Right? It happens though. Many a times our relatives, when they come to see us, they say, I am the uncle of your aunties, you know, this and that. And that is very far off relative. Okay. So this entire concept is basically coming from this polynomial concept itself. Okay. If you are interested in seeing the graph of this polynomial, I will show you. Because many of you would like to see how is this touching and cutting happening. So everybody, please note this down and dictate it to me when I ask you. Or somebody can take the initiative. Please note this down. I'm going to GeoGebra and I'm going to sketch this out. By the way, my memory should be able to remember this as far as possible. I have absolutely short memory. So y is equal to, if I was not mistaken, it was x minus 1. X minus 3 whole square. And x plus 1, right? I hope I have correctly copied it. Correct? No. There you go. See, this is what I was trying to tell you. Small. Yeah. So as you can see, this function is cutting at minus 1. Let me remove other things. Yeah, cutting at minus 1, cutting at 1, but touching at 3. Right? So when you're trying to make a wavy curve for this inequality, this is how you're going to react. Okay, so let me make it here. So whenever you're trying to solve this inequality, what was the approach which I told you? Make these numbers on the number line. Okay, choose the sign to the rightmost interval. So if I put a 4, I will get a positive quantity. Now start moving towards the left. The first number you see is a 3. 3 is subjected to even power, so there will be no change in the sign. Plus will remain plus, retention of sign. 1 comes from this factor, which has got an odd power on top of it. Odd means switch. Then minus 1 comes from this factor, which has again odd power on it. So that means again, you have to switch. So this will become a plus. So this plus, plus, minus, plus basically shows the way this graph is positioned above or below the x-axis. Whenever it is above, it will show plus in that interval. Whenever it is below, it will show minus in that interval. Okay. So I didn't want to go into this depth because anyways, I would have taken a session on this in our theory of equations chapter, but this is the reason behind it. Maybe your school teacher would have also told you, why do we take a plus minus like this? Okay. Achintya has a question. So why did we eliminate the denominator? We did not eliminate the denominator. We did not eliminate it. We basically multiplied with the denominator once more so that it gets an even power on it. And if it gets an even power on it, we can basically take it to the other side and vanish it off, thereby leaving a polynomial inequality, Achintya. And polynomial is something which we have already learned. We know how this graph and all will come. So from there, we are basically diverting our analysis, right? So we are basically diverting our analysis to solving a polynomial inequality, which is easier for us. Got the point? Okay. So I hope this process is well understood by everybody. So we will take few questions because I want you to be very, very good with your wavy curve sine scheme. Okay. The other day, your senior was saying, sir, we can use the baby curve sine scheme. It's not a baby curve, it's a wavy curve. Okay. We'll take few questions. Okay. Then we'll see the application part. So solve this inequality, everybody. X plus 2 to the power of 3, X minus 2 to the power of 4, X plus 1 to the power of 6, divided by X minus 7 to the power of 5, X plus 4 to the power of 2, and let's say X plus 3 to the power of 1. Chalo. Okay. Solve this inequality. Okay. I hope I have not given you a very heavier one. Because if you know your basics, you should be able to get this also. Don't be scared. No. Don't get rid of the denominator, etc. Just follow the rule of solving it. When I explained the process, basically I basically got rid of the denominator, but while following the actual method, don't get rid of anything. Think whatever was told to you in the left side of the screen, that is what you have to follow. Okay. I told the reason for doing it in the right side. Reason is don't implement the reason right now, implement the actual steps. If you are done, you can just say done also. There's no need to type out your answer, but if you can do so, nothing like that. Could you go back to that? What do you want to take some reference from there? Okay, I'll just go back momentarily and come back again. Awesome, Achintya has given an answer. Good, Achintya, we'll see that. Meanwhile, Arya wants to copy something. Done, 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 done. Okay, we'll go back. Don't worry, you will not get such a heavy inequality in your school exams or competitive exams. But the concept is not difficult either, right? If you know how to solve it, whether you raise it to power of 5 or 6 or 100 or 2000 doesn't make a difference. Done. Arya is done. Achintya is done. Who else? Come on, guys. Jaldi karo. We'll have to take a break also. Arnav is done. Very good. Jotin is done. Shashank is done. Aryan J is done. Very good. Vishal is done. Tanvi is done. Okay, in another 40 seconds, we will start the discussion. So those who want to give the response as they're done or the answer, both are welcome. Please do so. Then we'll start the discussion. Now, after knowing the concept, we will see its application also. Don't worry about it. So we'll see it in our domain range concept. So how is this helping us in our domain range concept? We will see it in some time. Okay. Should we start the discussion? Okay. First thing, does it meet the requirement for me to use a wavy curve? You will say, yes, sir. Left side is completely factorizable. Right hand side is zero. That is something which is very important. Don't miss out on that. Don't again jump to the wavy curve blindly. First, see, is it a case where I can apply wavy curve? Yes, I can apply. Left side, I have a factorized rational function. It should be factorizable. Right side, I have a zero. In between, whatever inequality is there, I don't care. I can solve all of them. Okay. Less than equal to, greater than equal to, all the four cases I can solve. So first thing is, once you have done that, please write down the zeros of each of these factors on a number line. I can see the least of them is minus 4. So I'll start with the minus 4. Okay. Then I think the next one is a minus 3. So minus 3. Next one is a minus 2. Next one is a minus 1. Then I can see a 2. And then I can see a 7. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yes. So all six factors have been listed down on this number line. Is this fine, everybody? I hope you have listed down the correct zeros on the number line. Okay. Now start with the rightmost interval. So the rightmost interval, this interval, and choose any value in that interval. So choose any value more than 7. Anything. Let's say I choose a 10. 10 plus 3 cube, positive. 10 minus 2, 4, positive. 10 plus 1 to the power 6, positive. 10 minus 7 to the power 5, positive. 10 plus 4 to the power 2, positive. 10 plus 3 to the power 1, positive. Everything is positive, so this guy is bound to be positive. So write a big plus in that. Now start your journey towards the left. What is the first number I see? 7. 7 comes from this factor, the one which is sitting in the denominator, and it has got odd power on it. Odd means switch. Even means retain. Odd means switch. Even means retain. Okay. So I'm singing like I'm teaching a kindergarten students. So 7 has, this guy has got a odd power. So it will be switching. So plus will become minus. Clear? Is it clear? Okay. Next guy is a 2. 2 comes from this factor, which has got an even power on that. Even means retain. So whatever you wrote here, the same sign you will retain over here. So minus was there, so minus will only come there. Got it? Next, minus 1 comes from this factor, x plus 1, which again has an even power. So again, you will retain. Got it? Now, minus 2 comes from x plus 2 to the power 3, which has got odd power. Odd means switch. So minus will become plus. Clear? Minus 3 comes from x plus 3, which has again an odd power. Again means odd means switch. So plus will become minus. And finally, minus 4 comes from x plus 4 square. Square means even power. Even means retain. So if this is the signs you have got for these intervals, then you are on the right track. If you have made a mistake in these signs, means gone. Okay. Because if these signs go wrong, then nobody can save you. The problem is bound to become wrong. The answer is bound to become wrong. Okay. Oh, see, Achintya wants to change the answer. No problem, Achintya. We are learning it. It's just the second problem that we are doing on this concept. Never mind. Even if a mistake has happened, not to worry. Now, what are we trying to solve? Less than or equal to zero means I'm trying to see in which interval is my function, this rational function, whole function, either negative or equal to zero. So wherever you have written a negative sign, write down those intervals. So first interval that I would write is minus infinity to minus 4. Then minus 4 to minus 3. Then minus 2 to minus 1. Then minus 1 to 2. That's it. Anything that I have missed out? Okay. Now, wherever it is becoming zero, that also should be, you know, taken apart. So zero, it becomes at minus 2, but minus 2 I've already included, so I don't need to write it again. It becomes at 2. 2 is also included. I do not need to include it again. Minus 1 is already included. No need to write again. Okay. So you don't have to write separate numbers. Okay. At least. Now coming to the brackets around these numbers, what kind of bracket will I put? Acha, ha, 2. Thank you. 2 to 7 is also there. Correct. Sorry, I didn't see that. 2 to 7. Thank you so much. Okay. So negative sign is here. So 5 intervals will come. Okay. Thank you, Jatin and Shashank. Thank you so much. Now I have to put brackets around these numbers. So what brackets will I put? See here. Minus infinity is always round brackets. Infinity minus infinity by default round brackets. Okay. Minus 4. Can I include minus 4? You say, sir, no, it is in the denominator. Minus 4 factor is x plus 4 whole square. It is sitting in the denominator. You can't put minus 4 because it will create 0 in the denominator. 0 in the denominator will make things undefined. So this also has to be round bracket. So this also will become round bracket because both are minus 4 only. Okay. Minus 3 again is sitting in the denominator, round bracket. Minus 2 is sitting on the numerator, which can be included. So square bracket. Very, very important. Okay. Minus 1 is again sitting on the numerator. So again, square bracket. So this will be square bracket once again. Okay. 2 will be again sitting on the numerator. So again, square bracket. Square bracket. 7 is sitting in the denominator. So round bracket. I hope you are able to understand. Again, you're able to understand where I'm putting round bracket and square brackets. A 7 to infinity will not come. No, even 7 to infinity, it is positive. I want less than equal to 0, my dear. Less than means negative. Why are you including 7 to infinity? Even we are basically looking for this interval, this inequality, no? Less than equal to 0. Less than means negative or 0, right? So negative jahan jahan likha hai, that interval you need to copy paste. Okay. Now we'll have to take the union of our answer. There you go. And that basically solves the question. So your x should belong to this interval. Done and dusted. Is it fine? How many of you got this exactly correct? I would like to see. Even if you have not, don't worry. Let me check. Achintya is claiming he has got it correct. Achintya is claiming he is right. Very good. Achintya, very good. Awesome. mess up with the brackets. Most of you are saying brackets went wrong. No issues. No issues. We'll take more questions. One more we'll take, Pearly, before going for a break. Is it fine? Okay. And then we'll see the application part of it. Okay. I hope you're not hungry. Stomach is doing good, good, sir. Let us have a break. Good, Vishal. Okay, let's take this question. Solve this inequality. 3 minus x to the power of 5, x minus 2 to the power of 4 upon x plus 1 to the power of 3. This time, let's solve only this guy, less than 0. Solve this inequality. Okay, Jatin, very good. Achintya, why are your answers different? Achintya and Jatin's answers are different. Okay, anyways, we'll check. We'll see who is right, who is wrong. Harshita, very good. Vishal, very good. Shoshank. Very good. You don't need to type and all. Arya, just say done. It's fine. It's more than enough for me. Aryan is also done. Okay. Arnav is also done. Good. Okay. Should we discuss it now? Okay. Let's discuss it. Not a big problem to solve, simple ones. We just have 3 factors involved. So first of all, number one check, is it a question where I can apply wavy curve sine scheme? Yes. Left-hand side is rational function, fully factorized. Right-hand side is 0. Very important. Okay. If right-hand side is not 0, you have to bring it to the left-hand side and again do the simplification before you proceed. Okay. That type of question also we will see in future, not immediately. Okay. Anyways. So what are the factors involved over here? The factors involved over here is 3 minus x to the power 5, x minus 2 to the power 4, x plus 1 whole cube. So I think the least one of them is minus 1. Then I have a 2. Then I have a 3. Okay. Now pay attention here. many people have this wrong conception that the right side is always positive. So I wanted to break that conception over here. Okay. So many a times, because in the previous few questions, they would have seen that only plus is coming to the rightmost interval. They take it for granted. They think that this will always be a plus. No, not like that. If you now take a number which is more than 3, let's say 4, this guy will be negative. This guy will be positive. This guy will be positive again. So overall, this will be negative. And I'm sure many of you would have made that mistake. Taking the rightmost interval positive by default is a blunder, I would say. Okay, don't be so overconfident that you make that mistake. Is it fine? Is it okay? Now, start moving to the left side. By the way, I'll remove these signs before I start the proceedings. Start moving to the left. So first you see a 3. 3 comes from the first, this guy having odd power on it. Odd means switch. Ayo, let me write it in white only. Yeah. Odd means switch. So minus will become plus. Then 2 comes from this factor having even power. Even means retain. Plus will remain plus. Then minus 1 comes from this power, which is odd. Odd means switch. So you'll have a minus, plus, plus, minus in your intervals. Okay. I hope people have got this right. Next, what are we trying to solve? We are trying to solve those intervals where it is negative. Less than 0 means negative. So wherever you have written a negative sign, state those intervals. Okay. Don't put a bracket right now. We'll put the bracket a little later on. Acha, bracket also. The moment you realize it's a pure inequality, that means less than only, there will be no square bracket ever. So by default, it will be everything round bracket. So don't waste time. Round, 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 take the union. So anybody who got this as the interval of X is absolutely right. Jatin got it? Great, Jatin. Very good. Anybody else who got it? Let me check. Let me check. Ah, Vishal got it. Very good, Vishal. Who else? Harshita, where is 2 coming from? Oh, in your answer, you have included a 2 by mistake. No. 2 will not be included because, yeah, that doesn't have to do anything with that. Is it fine? Okay. Not to worry, guys and girls. We'll be resuming with problems based on the wavy curve sign scheme with respect to domain and range. But before that, let's take a break. Let's take a break. Why is 3 in open brackets? Everything will be in open brackets, Achintya. Everything will be in open bracket because it is not less than equal to 0. I got it. If it is less than equal to 0, then I would have put a square bracket next to 3. Okay. So right now, ayo, my time is hidden. Yeah. The time is 6:21. Let's take it 6:22. We'll meet exactly at 6:37 p.m. after a small Kit Kat break. No worries, I will not change the slide. Okay. See you after the break. Bye bye. Tadax. Now, having discussed the previous methodology, which is your wavy curve sign scheme, now we'll start applying it. Where is it used? Okay. Of course, we will not get direct questions on it, but there will be a lot of applications that particular method has. So we'll see those applications in the questions of domain and range. So let me take the third case where I said you could have a situation where there is a quadratic in the denominator and there is a linear or a constant on the top. Okay. So I'll pick up such a question. Find the domain and range for the following function. A very simple one I'll begin with, maybe let's say 1 by 1 minus x squared. Okay, so you can see here we have a rational function which has got a constant on the top and a quadratic in the denominator. So how do you find the domain and range for such a question? Now allow me to solve one of them. You will get an idea from there. And I'll give you multiple subsequent questions based on that. Okay, so let me solve one of them for you. And then we'll take up. And then we'll take up more questions based on the same concept after this. So first, when it comes to domain, the concept of domain still remains the same. It will be all real numbers except those values of x, which will make the denominator become zero. Okay, I don't want the denominator to ever become a zero whenever there is a rational function like this. So this is very simple. On solving this guy, you only get 1 and minus 1 from here. So if you solve this, it means you're trying to say 1 minus x square. What is this? Yeah. When you're trying to solve this, you get 1 minus x square should not be 0. That means x square should not be 1. That means x should not be plus minus 1. Okay. So basically, your domain will be all real numbers except these two numbers. Okay. Your domain could be all real numbers except 1 and minus 1. That is not allowed to be put into this particular function. Any question related to domain? Anybody? No problem with domain. Okay, now comes to range. This is something which is important. So for finding the range, the process is more or less the same. Okay. We will first write down y as 1 minus x square. Okay. And then we'll write x or x square in terms of y. So this is how we can do it. Okay. You may write it like this, y minus 1 by y also. Okay. Now, all of you, please pay attention. Please pay attention. If your x belongs to all real numbers except 1 and minus 1, can I say x square will be all values in the positive real number. Let me write it like this. So this term will be greater than equal to 0 and should not be 1 and minus 1. Yes or no? If x is all real numbers, x square should be all positive numbers, including 0, but should not be 1 and a minus 1. Anyways, it will not be a minus 1. So you should say it should not be 1. Correct? Yes or no? Correct? So can I say this means y minus 1 by y should be greater than or equal to 0 and y minus 1 by y should not be 1? But this is anyways true. This guy is anyways true. Because if you do y minus 1 by y equal to 1, you will get a shock of your life giving you minus 1 equal to 0, which is anyways not possible. Yes, sir. So I need to ensure that y minus y should be greater than or equal to 0. Now, what do you have here? You have a wavy curve sine scheme to apply, which we have already done. And that too, we have done it to a very, you know, difficult level. This is a very simple one of that kind. Ewan wants me to scroll up. Where, Ewan, this point? You want to discuss domain here? Or you want to see domain? Okay, please note this up. Done, let me know once you're done. We'll go to the previous problem after we are done with this question. Arya, is that fine? See, if x is a real number, Achintya, x square will be greater than or equal to 0. Obvious. Square of any number which is real is a positive number greater than or equal to 0. And if you're not allowing x to become 1 and minus 1, which means x square will not become 1. So, if your x square is everything which is greater than 0 and not equal to 1, so should be y minus 1 by y as well. Correct? So y minus 1 by y should be greater than or equal to 0 and it should not be 1. Now this second guy is always true. Why? Because if y minus 1 by y becomes a 1, it is like you saying minus 1 is equal to 0, which is not possible. Okay. Now, coming to this point, this is something which we can easily solve by using our wavy curve. So now my wavy curve is basically asking us to solve or helping us to solve this inequality. So I'll put the zeros of this factors, x minus 1, 0 is a 1, y factor is a 0. Okay. All of you, please pay attention. Now, greater than or equal to 0, first of all, let me put the sign. So if I put a take any number greater than 1 and try to put it over here, I will get a positive answer from there, correct? Take a 2, 2 minus 1 by 2, positive number. Take a 5, 5 minus 1 by 5, positive number. Okay. Now, each of these factors are having odd powers on them. Even though it is not written, it is very obvious they have odd powers. So switching of sign will happen. Now, my question setter is asking me, when is it greater than or equal to 0? That means, when is it positive or equal to 0? So it is positive in this interval. Okay. So what kind of brackets will I use? Let's try to write. So minus infinity and infinity, you will always put round brackets. Minus infinity and infinity, you will always put round brackets. 0, can I include 0? You'll say no, sir. Because if you put 0, your denominator will vanish. So 0 cannot be included. Can I include 1? You'll say yes, sir. So 1 can be included. Correct. So the union of these two, the union of these two is what we will be getting as an answer to this question. Is this fine? Is this fine? Any questions? So this will become your range of this particular problem. Now, we will verify this. We will verify this on our GeoGebra. We'll see, does our graph and this result sync with each other? So is my domain really all real numbers except 1 and minus 1? Is my range really everything from minus infinity to 0 and 1 to infinity? Let's verify it from our graph. Okay. So first note this down. If you have any questions, do let me know. Okay, everybody is happy? Okay, so let's go to the graph of GeoGebra. So I'll mute this and I will plot y is equal to 1 upon 1 minus x square. There you go. Now watch out this graph very, very carefully. I'll just zoom in a bit. You can see that this function spans all the way from minus infinity to plus infinity. Only at 1 and minus 1, you can see the graph is having asymptotes. That means the graph is not able to achieve those values. So 1 and minus 1. See, I've drawn the 1 and minus 1 lines. So it becomes asymptotic to that line. Asymptotic means it's not able to achieve that value. It's coming very close and close and close and close and close and close, but never able to touch it. That is what is the meaning, that it cannot take 1 and minus 1. Now see the span of the graph along the y-axis. It's coming all the way from minus infinity. See, all the way it is coming from minus infinity till 0. 0 it is not able to achieve. So minus infinity to 0, 0 it is not able to achieve. And then it starts from 1 onwards. And then it starts from 1 onwards and goes all the way till plus infinity. Do you see that? So the graph tells you everything. The graph tells you domain, the graph tells you the range in one shot. So whatever we have done is in sync with what the graph is also suggesting us. Are you getting this point? So you don't have to always sketch the graph to know your domain and range. We can do without it as well. Is this fine? Now I'm sure you would like to solve more questions on this concept. So let's take more questions. Everybody, please try this one out. find the domain and range for this function. x upon 1 plus x square. X upon 1 plus x square. Everybody try it out. If you get stuck, I'll be helping you out. Now, instead of a constant, I have put a linear term on the top. I want to see how you are able to tackle this. Take 2 minutes time, and if you are stuck, I will be helping you out. Don't worry. See, root negative 1 is a non-real quantity, Achintya. Remember, I am dealing with real valued functions. Right? I cannot put anything which is non-real into the functions. Neither can I expect anything to be non-real coming out of the function. So, don't worry. I'll correct that answers of yours a little later on. But let's wait for others to respond. Let's see what... Right. Now your answer is correct. Now your answer is correct. See, what you wrote was an incorrect statement. You are removing a non-real quantity from a real quantity, which itself doesn't make sense. If you're asking whether your answer is right or not, Arya, I will say no. That is wrong. We'll discuss it, Arya, no issues. Try it out. Answer is correct, Harshita. Domain is correct. Go for range. Range is slightly challenging, as you will realize in some time that finding range is not that easy as finding domain is. That's why people lose marks, not in the domain questions, but in the range questions. Okay, Achintya, good. Can you write that as an integral? Achintya, can you write that terms in terms of an integral? Absolutely correct. Good. Again, minus one should be to the left. Remember, in any interval that you write, whether open interval, close interval, the smaller number should be on the left. The larger number should be on the right. Very good, Achintya. Anybody else who would like to contribute to the range part of it? I think domain, many of you have given the right answer. Or even if you're stuck, tell me I'm stuck so that, you know, I know how many of you are stuck somewhere. We'll discuss, not necessarily Arya, you can do without that as well. Okay, I'll give one more minute to the people who are trying hard and then we can start the discussion. Yeah, so if it is not possible, then don't remove anything, no? Don't remove anything. Basically, what does the definition say? Remove those values of x or those real values for which the denominator becomes zero. And if you think denominator doesn't become a zero, then don't remove anything. So your answer becomes all real numbers. Right, Jatin? Yes. Chalo, we will discuss it, guys. Thank you. All of you have given a best shot. You have tried hard. Let's discuss it. So for the domain, the process is the normal one, which we have been following since the beginning of the rational function discussion. All real numbers except those values which will make the denominator become zero. But there is no such value of x which will make denominator zero. So this is going to be a null set. So basically you have R minus null set, which is R only. So domain is all real numbers. Is it fine? Clear, Arya? Right, so don't forcibly try to make your denominator zero. If it is not zero, then accept the fact that you are not going to remove anything from the real number. So your answer is real numbers. Okay. Now coming to the range part of it. For the range part, the process becomes slightly deviated from whatever we have done, because in this case, you realize you will not be able to, let's cross multiply, you will not be able to separate out the, you know, x completely in terms of y. But you don't have to do that always. In this case, you will see here that you are getting a quadratic in x. So treat this as if you have written a quadratic in x. Okay. What do you have written? A quadratic in x, something like ax square bx plus c, right? So a is your y, b is minus 1, c is y, something like that. Okay. So when you use the Sridhar Acharya formula or the quadratic equation formula to solve it, you get x as minus b plus minus under root b square minus 4 AC by 2A. Correct. Now you can see I have written X completely in terms of Y. So let me just simplify this. Is everybody happy till this step? Then only I will move forward. Are you all happy with this? So first, what did I do? Equated it to Y like the normal way. I, you know, took the denominator, I got a quadratic in x. I use my Sridhar Acharya formula, the quadratic equation formula, what you know it as, and I got my x in terms of y. Everybody's happy till this stage. Then only I'll proceed further. Happy? Okay. Now all of you, please pay attention. Since your X is all real numbers, this is what is our domain requirement. It means this guy should be taking all real values. Yes or no? Since X is all real number, this guy should also be real number. Yes or no? Correct. Now for this to be real number, tell me what are the situations or what are the restrictions you need to honor? If you want this guy to be real number, what are the things you need to honor? You will say, sir, the thing which is under the root should be greater than or equal to zero. Agreed. Next. Next, is this the only condition you need to honor? Achitya? Right. And somebody would say, sir, 2y should not be 0. Right? Guys, this is something which we need to actually verify. This condition, the second condition, may not be honored. I know you will be surprised, right? But I'll show you. In some situations, we need not honor the second condition, but nevertheless, we will take a cognizance of that and we'll try to verify it, whether actually y should not be 0 or y can be 0 also. That means 0 chalega, correct? So Achintya and Arlav, point taken, but we need to verify the second thing. Okay, let's see. We'll do it one by one. So the very first guy says this. Now, this is as good as your wavy curve sine scheme. So I can write it like this. By the way, all of you know that I can factorize it like this. See, wavy curve will only work on factors, isn't it? So I can write it as 1 minus 2y, 1 plus 2y greater than or equal to 0. So for this, you know the approach. The approach is we make a number line, write the zeros of these factors. So I think minus half and half will be the zeros. Take a number more than half. Let's say I take a 1, I'll get a negative. So this will be negative. Then switching of sign will happen 2 times because they are all factors which have odd powers on them. Correct. Now my question setter is asking me, where is it greater than equal to 0? So greater than equal to 0 means positive or 0. That is only between minus half to half. Okay. So your y should belong to minus half to half. This result comes out from the first one. Okay. Let me call it as, condition number A. Okay. Condition number B says, condition number two says, y should not be 0. Now, is it really true? Is it really true that y cannot be 0? I don't think so, because if you go to this expression, it clearly tells you that when x is 0, y is 0. Right? So what does this say? Y can be 0. Why not? Why not? Y can be 0. Who is stopping y from becoming 0? Nobody can. When x is 0, y is 0. So when I wrote a verify here, basically it came out that this particular restriction is undue. You don't require this restriction. So I'll score it off. This restriction condition is not required. Sometimes it may be required, but you need to verify whether that condition is actually legitimate or not. Now, many people ask me, sir, why it is working? Because in this case, as I understood that when x is 0, y is 0, but why is it working? Now, all of you will realize that when y is 0, the numerator also can become a 0 if you take a minus sign. See, 1 minus under root 1, which is 0, 0 by 0. 0 by 0 is an indeterminate form. Indeterminate can have a finite answers to it. Are you getting my point? And because of that, 0 can be allowed in this case. Yes, I agree to the fact that in some cases, you may have to exclude the values for which the denominator is becoming 0. But that is only when you have verified it. It's very important. Even in school, teachers make a mistake like this. They'll say, oh, 0 is not allowed. But first check it out. Because there is nothing better than this equation to tell that y can become 0, right? Who is this method to tell me when I know that x is 0, y is 0? Finish. Right? Why should I exclude 0 unnecessarily? Why should I exclude 0? Are you getting my point? So don't buy these statements blindly that, you know, since y is coming in the denominator, y cannot be 0. Okay. So the final verdict that you get is only condition number A, and this becomes your range as well. So range is all values from minus half to half. This is your answer. Simple as that. Don't exclude 0. You will get a wrong result. Okay. Let's do a verification of this from our graph. What does the graph have to say? Let's go to the graph. So y is equal to y is equal to x divided by 1 plus x squared. There you go. And you can see this graph domain is all real numbers. See the span along the x-axis. I hope you can see my camera. Minus infinity to infinity, right? But along the y-axis, you can see it is only sandwiched between half and minus half. Half and minus half. Okay. And you can clearly see zero is taken by the answer. No, see here, it is taking a zero. Y is becoming zero here. It is passing through that point. Okay. So the second condition that you are getting that needs to be verified. Please note this down because people have lost marks because of, you know, writing a blind answer. Okay. Is it clear? Any questions, any concerns with respect to the solution of this question? Can I give you another one? Will you be trying that out? Okay, Achintya has a question. Sir, in a condition where zero can't be taken, how do we do it? Zero can't be taken out. Achha. If you realize that you are getting a term in the denominator and you are trying to see for what value of y is that term becoming zero, let's say a number will come out from it. In this case, the number is zero. Let's say you had a 2y minus 1, let's say. 2 times y minus 1, then y will become 1. So just put a 1 here and try to solve the quadratic. Are you getting any real root for that? If yes, then y equal to 1 is a possibility. That means range will have 1 in it. But if you're getting a non-real answer from there, that means this quadratic, whatever you got, was a non-real one. That means this equation was correct, that y cannot be 1. Is it clear? Yeah, so basically what I was trying to say, Arya, was that when you are getting an indication that y cannot take a certain value because the denominator will go 0, try to put that value manually here and solve for x. Are you getting an x value for which y is taking that answer? If you're getting an answer, that means the second condition is null and void. You don't have to honor it. You have to just honor the first guy. Got it? Chalo, we'll take more questions. I think with more questions, clarity will come. Let's try this one out. Find the domain and the range of now see, I'm complicating it. Now I'm taking a question where you have quadratic in the numerator also and quadratic in the denominator also. Approach is not going to change. Same approach. I want to see whether you are able to take that approach. Try this out. Find domain and the range of this. So here we have a case where my rational function is made up of quadratic, both in the numerator and denominator. Both are quadratic. Correct, Arya. Very good. Correct, Achintya. Correct, Jatin. Very good, Arnav. That's right. The अरे तूने मुझे बुलाया शेरावालिए, मैं आया शेरावालिए. I'm more interested in range. Let me see who gives me the range answer. I'm more interested in seeing that result. What do you see blessings from the previous question? Give me some blessings. I'm trying the new one. Yeah. Vihan. The answer for the range is not matching with yours. What if it is not quadratic? Then fine. If it is not quadratic, you write x in terms of y, no? Achintya, that's absolutely correct. Well done, boy. Awesome. Good. Absolutely correct. I'm so happy to see somebody getting this right. By the way, Arya, can I go back to the next slide? Anything that you would like to know? Okay, thank you. Awesome, Achintya. Very good. Good. Who else? Achintya, and are you related to Aniruddha? No, I think Aryashri is related, friend of Aniruddha. Okay. Yes, anybody? Should we discuss it? Partly correct, Arnav. One of your figures is correct, but not completely correct. Never mind. Chalo guys, we'll discuss it out. Okay. If you have any issues, I think after I solve this, things will be resolved. We will check, Arya. We'll check. See. So first of all, the domain is the easiest part. Okay. So domain is basically all real numbers except those values of x which will make the denominator polynomial go zero. But if you see, denominator polynomial can never be zero because this can actually be written as x plus half the whole square plus 3 by 4. So this will always be more than 3 by 4. It can never be zero. And even if you try to solve for it, you will get non-real values. Correct. This will not have real. A discriminant would be negative, so as to say. Okay, that's another way of looking at it. So ultimately, this will give you no answer. That means R minus null set. which means R. So domain will be all real numbers. That most of you got it right. Okay. So everybody is getting domain as all real numbers. So this guy will work for any input you give it to it. Zero dal do, no farak padega. Okay. Now let's talk about range. For range, some of you have got stuck somewhere. So let's try to figure it out. So the range process is same. You will have to either write x in terms of y or get a quadratic in x. That is the two possibility that will happen. So let's do that. Let's see which of the possibility arises. So if you take the denominator to the right side, sorry, left side, you'll end up getting x square y plus xy plus y is equal to x square minus x plus 1. If you take x squares together, you'll end up getting something like this. If you take x together, you get something like this. And if you take the non-x terms together, you end up getting something like this, right? So treat this as if you have written x square into a, or let me write a in a shorter way. I mean, in smalls, not in caps. So ax square plus bx plus c kind of a scenario. Just compare it with this. So basically what I'm trying to say is that this is a quadratic in x. Now, Arya, the reason why you lost an x is because you canceled this out. I don't know why. Why on this planet Earth?
No, sir, I didn't cancel it out. Then? I took, in the first two terms, I multiplied it, x square into y. Okay, I took, something I took common out. One second.
Something.
No, okay, x square I took common out. No, I got it on the other side, okay, x square.
If you give this to the other side, you'll get 1 minus y on the other side. But why will you lose an x square?
Sir, and then from the first two terms, I took x common out.
So?
Okay, I did something else.
No, x, you will not lose x square. You will not lose any of the terms, don't worry. Okay.
Okay.
Now, once you've got a quadratic in x, you can use your Sridhar Acharya formula. Or Sridhar Acharya formula, minus b plus minus b square minus 4ac by 2a. Okay. Now, having got this, now please recall what was your domain. Domain was your x could be any real number, which means this whole thing, this guy, whole thingy, I will write it down again, unfortunately. Okay. By the way, I'll do some simplification in between over here. So this I will write it as minus 2y minus 1 the whole square. I hope you are fine with that, because 4y minus 1 whole square, I can write it like this. Okay. By twice of y minus 1. Even this should be real, yes or no? Now, what are the restrictions we need to entertain, or what are the conditions which we need to entertain for ensuring that this is real? So you'll say, sir, number one, the quantity which you have written under the root symbol, that should be greater than or equal to zero. Agreed. Why? Because if this is less than zero, under root of a quantity less than zero will yield a negative, will yield a non-real answer. So this whole thing will become non-real, which I don't want. I want it to be real. Right. And second condition, you will say, sir, this guy in the denominator, that should not be zero, but again, this is subject to verification. So I will write verification or verify as of now here. We will verify it separately. Whether really y cannot become a one or not. We will see, we'll check. Okay. First, we will try to see what comes from the very first scenario. So this guy, if you see this on simplification, this will give you y plus 1 plus 2y minus 1. I'm using a square minus b square factorization, and y plus 1 minus 2y minus 1. Okay. This on simplification gives you 3y minus 1. Correct me if I'm wrong. And this gives me 3 minus y. Okay. So for this, let me recall my wavy curve sine scheme. That is going to be a very helpful method to solve this inequality. So first write down the zeros of these two factors. I think this guy will give me 1/3. This guy will give me a 3. And let's start assigning signs to these three intervals. Take a number more than 3 in your mind. Let's say 4. So I think 12 minus 1 is positive, but 3 minus 4 is negative. So this guy is negative. And now all these powers are odd. That means keep switching. Okay. Plus, minus. Now the question setter is asking, where is it greater than or equal to 0? That means where is it positive or 0? So it is clear that it is positive between 1/3 to 1/3. And at 1/3 and 1/3, it is 0. So this is what you are going to get out of the first condition. Okay, so this is the outcome from your first condition. Let's call it as A as of now. Okay. Now the second condition says, Y cannot be 1. But I will not take this on the face value. I will go and check whether Y really cannot be 1. But I can get my answer pretty straight forward. If your X is 0, Y will be 1. So there is no reason to exclude 1 from your range, isn't it? So when X is 0, you can see yourself that your right hand side will become a 1. Isn't it? X equal to 0 is the real number. I'm feeding this as a 0 inside it. It is giving me the answer as 1. So why should I exclude 1? This condition is absolutely redundant. I will not honor this condition. That means I will not honor the fact that Y cannot be 1. Y can be 1. Y can be 1 very much. So this is the only thing that you're going to get. So this becomes your answer. Is this fine? I think only Achintya got this absolutely correct. Rest people made some mistakes here and there. Shili mistake. Shili, there is nothing called Shili. Shake chili. If let's say 1 was not possible, then you could have written it like that also, Achintya. Or you just say minus curly brackets 1. That is also fine. Is it okay? Should we do one more question before we end this session? Okay. By the way, there are many more things to be covered up. In the next class, we'll be talking about irrational functions, logarithmic functions, exponential functions, a bit of trig, inverse trig, and piecewise. That should be fast. I would not spend too much time on that. Okay, let's take this question. Find the domain and range for Satyajit, I is an imaginary number. You're trying to say I'm excluding I from real numbers. I is anyways not a part of real numbers. It's trying to say, sir, I am throwing you out of my house. I'm anyways not at your house. Okay. No, sir, you're most welcome to my house, sir. Why should I throw you out of my house? Right, Arya. That's correct. In your school, primarily they are going to revolve around this concept. Maybe some questions on irrational domain and range will be asked, which I will take in the next class. Next class will be slightly faster. We will not take a lot of examples, but we'll just keep on understanding the concept, because I need to start with trigonometry also, because it's a huge chapter. Trig is a huge chapter, and I'm sure you would have started trig in your school. Trigonometry has got so many sub chapters under it. Okay, Jatin, are you sure? Because okay, we'll see. Give your best shot, everybody. We'll see. Yeah, please have a relook at whatever you have done. I'm sure something has gone wrong. Okay, Vihan. Guys, one more minute I'm going to give you, and then I'm going to start the discussion. Fine. Okay, Ashita. Please, everybody participate. I should not be taking names. Smithy, Sri Venkat, Omesh, Harshada, Avnish. See, whatever I'm teaching, I have not even started with the JE part. It's just school level. Okay. See, our approach is always from school and then higher, right? So this is all important part of your school syllabus also. This lady wants blessing from the previous question. Huh? Just a second. Yeah. Okay, Achintya, Harshita. Yes, Arya, tell me where you want to see. What do you want to see? Which wave? This guy, wavy curve. Okay. All right. Let's discuss it. Time is less. Just 4 minutes. Two minutes is too much. The question lifespan is just 4 minutes. After that, it is like either you solve it or you quit. We don't have much time. I think 3 minutes is left. See, it's not a very difficult question. Just follow it. Domain will be what? Domain will be all real numbers except those values of x, which will make the denominator go zero, but denominator can never become zero. So basically, it's all real numbers minus a null set, which is all real numbers. Okay. So this is going to be a real this is going to be a domain. Okay. All right. We'll check the range. So for range, okay, Satyajit. We'll discuss it, Arya. Let's figure it out. So first of all, write it as a y. cross multiply, take the denominator to the left and write it as a quadratic, something like this. Okay, and you can do this as well. You can do this as well, not an issue. Okay. So here it is basically a simpler case because you can write x square completely in terms of y like this. Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. Now, if you know your x is real, it means your x square should be greater than or equal to 0. Correct? Yes or no? Which means 1 plus y by 1 minus y should be greater than or equal to 0. Yes or no? This is a simple, simple wavy curve question. Correct? So now, plot the zeros of these two factors over here. So one is minus 1, other is 1. Let us assign sign to these intervals. So if you take something greater than 1, let's say 2, this will become 3 by minus 1. So this will be negative. This will be positive. This will be negative again. Clear? Now, greater than or equal to 0 means positive or equal to 0. So can I say minus 1 to 1, but I cannot include 1. I can only include a minus 1. Because if I include a 1, y will become a 0. Denominator will become a 0. And if denominator becomes a 0, that is not permissible. Okay. So those who have said square bracket minus 1 to 1, let me tell you, my dear students, unfortunately, that answer will be sitting in your options. And you will confidently mark it right and lose one mark. Okay, be careful. See, anyways, you can test that this guy cannot become a 1. If you put this equal to 1, it means you're trying to say, if this can become a 1, that means you're trying to say x square minus 1 can become x square plus 1. Means you're trying to say minus 1 is equal to 1, right? Not possible. Okay, so it can never achieve 1. It will be round brackets there. Is it clear? Any questions, any concerns? You got square brackets because of that. Okay. Send me your solution, Achintya. Yeah. Okay. So with this, we'll stop today's session. Next class will be the very vital one because I'm going to go beyond your school level concept of domain and range. Please do not miss out on that class. Don't be late because I'm going to talk things which may not be present directly in your textbook. Okay. So till then, take care. Good night. Shabba khair. Stay safe, everybody. Thank you.